Well, good morning, everybody. Happy Father's Day. We're glad to have you with us this morning. I believe we're starting with a couple hymns here.
No?
Leanne has some announcements. We'll get it together.
He doesn't even know. Happy Father's Day. The name of this poem is Dad's Hands. Dad's hands were king size and strong. With his hands, he built our home and fixed all the broken things. Dad's hand gave generously, served humbly, and loved Mom tenderly, unselfishly, completely, and unendingly. With his hands, Dad held me when I was small, steadied me when I stumbled, and guided me in the right direction. When I needed help, I could always count on Dad's hands. Sometimes Dad's hands corrected me, disciplined me, shielded me, rescued me. Dad's hands protected me. Dad's hands held mine when we walked down the aisle, and he gave me love and support on my wedding day. Dad's hands were an instrument of his great, big, rugged, tender heart. His hands were strength. His hands were love. With his hands, he praised God. And he prayed to the Father with those big hands. Dad's hands, they were like Jesus' hands to me. I thought that one was really cool. Is it up there?
It is good, good Father. Yep, it's up on the... Make sure you've got control there. Good.
This is our abbreviated praise band.
Me.
Thought I'd outdo my buddy Steven and do one more song for you. Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth a looking away? We are free in ways that we never should be. Sweet release from the grip of these chains. Like hinges straining from the wave, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries, for you alone be glorified. Emmanuel, God with us. Don't deserve your glory, but still you show a love we cannot afford. Like hinges straining from the weight, my heart no longer can keep from sinking. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary, but nevertheless, we lay this at your feet. All that is within me cries for you alone. So the lyrics are, my heart sings a brand new song, the debt is paid, my chains are gone. Emmanuel, God with us. But my heart doesn't sing, it's a metaphor, but I like the metaphor, it's interesting to me. We share the gospel hoping people will ask Jesus into their heart. But what does that mean? Bruce tells the story of his son accepting Jesus into his heart and looking down and saying, "Are you comfortable in there?" We literally imagine him in our heart, but he's not literally in our heart. But that's just the way our minds work. I look at it figuratively, like I dream of Jeannie. She would go down into the bottle, and it's this tiny little thing, but then they'd show the set, and it looks like that bottle. So you imagine that tiny little bottle. And so that's where Christ is. He's in your heart, but he's in this little room that you can imagine. And when things didn't go my way when I was a child, I would figuratively or imagine kicking Christ out of my heart and allowing the devil to come in. And that, it's, for years I feared this unforgivable thing I'd done until I read Victory Over the Darkness, where it's explained how all I had to do was simply ask forgiveness for my past sins and be unburdened of the guilt. And it should be simple, but we hold on to things and say he couldn't let that go. He couldn't forgive that. He hung on that cross, but this one I have to hold on to. He's not going to forgive that one. So I got to keep that. It says, "Resist the devil and he will flee from you. He won't flee if you defend him and saying, 'I deserve to be tormented by sin and evil for the things I've done.' It has to be a conscious choice of yours, remembering that Christ already paid the price on the cross. Perhaps we've forgotten. We need to be reminded. So when it says in Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But it doesn't mean my blood-pumping organ in my chest. It doesn't mean the relative center of my being. It's my innermost thoughts, my subconscious. That is my heart. So I could say right now, yeah, I believe in God, but this tiny little doubt in my head says kinda, or maybe I do, or sometimes. That's my heart. That's my doubt. That's where I need to accept him on every single level of my mind, being, subconscious, everything. He has to be accepted within my heart of thoughts. In the movie, I can only imagine the band Mercy Me, whose song I just sang, is trying to hit it big, and they're at their concert, and all these talent scouts come to watch them perform, and afterwards, they didn't get a good response. They didn't get the sign-up like they wanted. So the lead singer storms in to find out why, and one of the guys says, "I wasn't buying it. You weren't wholeheartedly invested in what you were doing, and it shows." And the lead singer was hurt by that, that this guy he had just met was doubting his belief in God. He could see the spark of inspiration was dim inside of him. You can have all the words right memorized and still not know your Father in heaven for certain. And it was the change in his father, once his father started reading the Bible, that unlocked what he was holding back from his father so that he could accept him wholeheartedly. The bad relationship with his dad made a bad relationship with his heavenly father, so it was miskewed. He was unable to understand how their dynamic was supposed to work out because he'd only ever been mistreated by his dad. We've all heard the phrase, "in your heart of hearts," or "their heart's just not in the right place anymore." You may still be doing or even being productive, but all your passion and energy is gone. And our Father in heaven can relight our flame inside, reignite us, make us passionate again. But we need to truly deep down in all the ways of our mind acknowledge he exists, in your innermost thoughts, where you talk to you. In the beginning, God made the heavens and the earth. Do you believe that? But do you really? It says in John 1:1-5, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, and yet the darkness did not overcome it." So if I want life in the fullest, and I want my light to shine before others, that they may see my good works and glorify my Father in heaven, I have to accept Jesus in my heart of hearts. I have to truly and honestly believe, and with everything I've got, there is no doubt, even in here where no one can see, I believe it all. My innermost thoughts. I need to be more like King David, whom the Word says he was a man after God's own heart. Did he make mistakes, though? Huge. Have you ever heard of Bathsheba? Short version, David had an adulterous affair, tried to cover up the pregnancy by having the woman's husband brought back from battle to sleep with his wife and assume the child was his. When that didn't work, King David had Uriah, her husband, sent to the most intense part of the battle to be killed and wash his hands of the sinful actions and guilt. And this was a man after God's own heart? I ask myself reading things like that, because it doesn't seem like he was focused at all. It says in 2 Samuel chapter 12, the title's Nathan's Parable and David's Repentance. So the Lord sent Nathan to David. When he arrived, he said to him, "There were two men in a certain city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very large flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one small ewe lamb that he had bought. He raised her, he grew up with him, and she grew up with him and with his children. From his meager food she would eat from his cup, she would drink, and in his arms she would sleep. She was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man could not bring himself to take one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for his guests. David was infuriated with the man and said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. Because he has done this thing and shown no pity, he must pay four lambs for that lamb." Nathan replied to David, "You are the man. This is what the Lord God of Israel says. I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from Saul. I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms, and I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that was not enough, I would have given you even more. Why then have you despised the Lord's command by doing what I considered evil? You struck down Uriah the Hethite with the sword and took his wife as your own wife. You murdered him with the Ammonite's sword. Now therefore the sword will never leave your house because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hethite to be your own wife. This is what the Lord says, I'm going to bring disaster on you from your own family. I will take your wives and give them to another before your very eyes, and he will sleep with them in broad daylight. You acted in secret, but I will do this before all Israel in broad daylight." David responded to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." Then Nathan replied to David, "And the Lord has taken away your sin. You will not die. However, because you treated the Lord with such contempt in this matter, the son born to you will die." Then Nathan went away. So King David was led by evil and gave in to his desire, which resulted in sin. But then he also repented and sought God's forgiveness, which is what he was supposed to do. He made the mistake, but then he knew he could be forgiven for it. That was the whole point. But you have to repent. You don't just keep on sinning and, "Oh, hey, just forgive all of it till the end, and then I get a quick forgiveness and I'm in heaven." You repent for the things you do wrong and try not to do them again. That's the point. We can't prevent what rolls through our internal sinful dialogue. David saw the woman. He lusted for her. He was the king. He denied himself nothing. He took her. Then he tried to cover it up. And then after all of that internal in his heart, what he had worked out, he realized none of that pleases God. I've completely failed. He repented. So he couldn't prevent that sin from rolling around in his mind. But we can resist those thoughts and train our minds to conquer sin and resist the devil's ploys and persuasions. We can be centered and focused on God and have a deep and meaningful relationship with our Father who is in heaven. Some people get false conceptions about God from movies, religious fanatics, their parents, or friends. Your understanding of God will affect every area of your life. If you have misconceptions about God and what he's really like, you're going to tend to worry about things you shouldn't be worrying about. You're going to feel guilty over things God has no intention of you feeling guilty about. You're going to carry unnecessary burdens and fears and doubts and depressions all through life that God never intended you to carry around. Unnecessary baggage. Your understanding of God will determine your happiness in life. If your misconceptions of God are really like that, you'll have unnecessary problems and misery that you are unintended to have. In Jesus, we get to see all the amazing attributes of our Heavenly Father, and with it, the destruction of all the stereotypes of God. Jesus shows us that God is not some impersonal, unapproachable force. God's not some angry tyrant who sits in heaven looking for ways to make people miserable, as some people would love to think. He's poking on me. He's not some pathetic creator who winds up the world and sets it down and watches what happens with no involvement. Jesus taught the disciples to pray, "Our Father," not "Dear Jesus' Father," not "Dear Almighty God," our Father. We can, we're part of the family. You're a child of God. You accept that in your heart of hearts. You can and should be close enough to call him your Father, says Jesus. Jesus, referring to God as his Father, helps us view God as a person and not just a power. It's hard to relate to an all-powerful cosmic being. But when you say God is a Father, I can relate to that. I can be intimate with a Father. I can talk to a Father. I can have a relationship with a Father. On the other hand, if your relationship with your earthly father has been anything but pleasant, the concept may invoke thoughts of anger, sadness, or even pain. And that's not where it's supposed to take you, but that's what our human mind does. That's what the fallen, sinful nature does. It puts those doubts in our mind, just like the snake. Did he really say that? Is it really like that? You should question these things. When I say the word father, it may stir up deep resentment. Maybe you had a father who was neglectful, or a father who was abusive, physically or verbally. A father who just wasn't there, or a non-entity in your life. Some of you, when you think of the word father, brings up fear. You remember phrases growing up, just wait until your father gets home. You remember, and if you think, if God is anything like my dad, no thanks, God. Human fathers can make homes a hell on earth. Human fathers can be selfish, they can be demanding, inconsistent. We can be self-centered, sometimes abusive. All kinds of things that we would say, I don't want that in my life. Jesus' distinction was not on God's location when we pray, but rather on the quality of our Father. Not the place he's at, but the fact that we can approach him like that. My kids are often upset at me and run off saying, I don't like you. Because I'm trying to teach them right from wrong, correcting them. But we earthly fathers are inconsistent where God never is. Rick Warren points out four common misconceptions about God that cause people to never establish the child-parent relationship approach that Jesus encourages. The first was some people think God's unreasonable. They don't get to know God because he puts all these unreasonable demands on their lives that they could never possibly live up to. All he wants to do is make my life tough, give rules, regulations, and restrictions. He wants to remove all the fun, enjoyment, and happiness. And if you feel that way, it's no wonder that you can't fully accept him in your heart. You may believe, but no one truly wants to get to know an unreasonable, demanding person or a God. The second, some people think he's unreliable. The reason for that may be because you've been hurt. It's an interesting characteristic of human behavior. When somebody hurts us, we not only blame that person, we blame God. If you've been attacked, or you've been put down, or you've been abused, you not only get mad at your attacker, you get mad at God. You say, God, why did you allow that? I've often asked, how could this have happened? It just doesn't seem right. I found myself shamefully thinking in my pain, not only did this horrible thing happen, but you stood up there and did nothing. Understanding God's working all things for the good of those who love him takes patience and biblical understanding. Sin does exist. Therefore, this world is not what it was meant to be, all this pain, all this suffering. There is a better place waiting for me in heaven. We can't be so easily dissuaded of our Father in heaven's goodness. In the Big Daddy Weave song, it says, I know that you are good, I know that you are kind, I know you are so much more than what I leave behind. I know I'm loved, I know that I am saved, because even in the fire, to live is Christ, to die is gain. I know that, but I have to remind myself, I have to be reminded by my Christian community, I need the fellowship, I need to read the word, I need to keep that connection strong, otherwise it dwindles out and I start to doubt. This here is the roadmap for the Father. You will encounter those who try to understand God based on worldly wisdom and understanding. And the hurt of this life will eventually cause some to say, I'm not going to trust anybody, and I'm certainly not going to trust God. They may still claim to believe in the word, but not in their heart. The third is some think God is unconcerned. They may say, oh yes, I believe there is a God. He's just too busy to bother me. He's just too busy to bother with little old me. How could he possibly be interested in me? God's got bigger things to worry about. If you don't know you're a lost sheep and that the Lord is willing to leave the 99 in search of little old you, then accepting him wholeheartedly would be difficult. But I assure you, as Christ does, he loves you and loved you enough to send his son to give his life for you. The fourth is some think God is unpleasable. You think that no matter how hard you try, it's never good enough in his eyes. What most of us tend to do is take the weaknesses of our parents and enforce them onto God. So if you grew up with unpleasant or unpleasable parents, you tend to think God is unpleasable. If you grew up with an aloof father, you tend to think God is an aloof father, and so forth. Whatever your parent was like, you tend to push that onto God. You mirror those characteristics and then assume he's acting like how you were brought up. All misconceptions need to be stripped away and replaced with that the Bible says about our Heavenly Father, so that our belief would be made easy and our faith made stronger. He is compassionate, loving, gracious, and he cares about you. In fact, he loves you more than you will ever know. He loves you more than you will be able to experience. But compassion is God's number one characteristic and attribute. In Psalm 104, it says, "As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who honor him." When the disciples were in the boat with Jesus and the storm kicked up and they were afraid that they were going to die, they woke him and asked, "Don't you care if we perish?" If you doubt God even cares about you, are you ever going to try and get to know him? But Jesus gets up and rebukes the winds and the waves, and he stops it. And then he asks him, "Why did you doubt?" "Well, we were about to die." that was the main reason. But you're over here sleeping like no big deal. "You have little faith," he says. And that's so, look into the storm and trust in the Father. Don't be afraid of what the wind's going to do. Don't be afraid of the waves. Don't be afraid of the boat tips over. Maybe he's going to teach you to swim. But you don't know. You just have to have faith in him. Not in the circumstance, not in the situation, not in the foreseeable outcome. My God's bigger than any situation, amen?
Amen?
Of course he cares if you perish. 1 Peter 5:7 says, "Cast all your cares on him because he cares about you." It doesn't say cast some of them or just the big ones that you need help with. It says cast all your cares on him. The Bible tells us about God that he is a consistent father. You can count on him every time. He will never let you down. He's always dependable, entirely consistent in who he is, and he is worthy of our trust. James 1:17 says, "Every good and perfect gift is from the Father, who does not change like shifting shadows." The truth is, earthly fathers are unpredictable. Some of them are incredibly unpredictable and fickle. I know some people who feel like, "I never know what to expect from my dad. It changes so much from one day to the other, depending entirely on the mood he's in. Some day he's silent, and the next he's violent. One day he's a good guy, and the next day he's a tough guy. I don't know what to expect." Inconsistent fathers produce insecure kids. 2 Timothy says, "Even if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot disown himself. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world." He accepts us because we're created in his image. We are a literal walking temple carrying his presence within us. He cares about you because he's in you. Amen? In all the man-made religions of the world, when we try to make up our idea of God, it's different. In man-made religions, God is always temperamental. Whether it's Greek gods or whatever, they're always fickle. You always have to appease the gods, one way or another. The true God in heaven is different. In Malachi 3:6, God is speaking and says, "I, the Lord, do not change," and we can count on that. Romans 11:29 says, "God will never go back on his promises." Psalms 49:10 says, "My God is changeless in his love for me." Your heavenly Father is a God who is close. Acts 17:27 says, "God did this so that people would reach out for him and find him, since he is not far from each of us." He's not thousands of miles up in the heaven. He's right here next to me. I have to understand that. I have to believe that. I have to embrace that. God wants you to find him. He wants you to know him. He wants you to have a relationship with him. He is a competent Father. He can handle any problem you give him. Nothing is beyond his ability, and nothing is beyond his resources. Today, this is a direct opposite to human fathers. We have an epidemic of incompetent fathers today who are good at a lot of other things, but pretty much lousy as fathers. Especially on TV, all the fathers are, they pretend, they act like idiots. At least most of them, they're portrayed, it's that stupid, funny, ha ha ha, he doesn't know how to do anything, but it's, it, you know, give us a little more credit, you know? And don't look at a man like that, because then you can't acknowledge that, you know, you have to respect that man and respect the God that created that man. That's just how it works. In Luke 1:37, nothing is impossible with God. Nothing is impossible. He can handle it all because he is competent. Ephesians 3:20 says, God is able to do far more than we would ever dare to ask or even dream of, infinitely beyond our highest prayers or desires or thoughts or hopes. What have you been doubting that God can handle today? What is it hidden in your heart that you never feel able to show God? It's time to let go and to let God. How do you become a part of the family of God? How do you become a child of God? How do you get God to be my heavenly Father? The Bible says, John 14:6 through 7, Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. Jesus said, that's why I came to earth, to show you the Father so that you could get to know him. So you have to read your Bible to know the Son to get to know the Father. And he said so himself. Galatians 3:26 says, we are the children of God through being religious. No, that's not what it says. It says we are the children of God by through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the only way you get into God's family. It's not by going to church. It's not by keeping the Ten Commandments. It's by through your faith in Jesus Christ. It's the only way to get into God's family. Children of God through faith. 1 Peter 1:3 says, God has given us the privilege of being born again so that we are now members of God's own family. A relationship to your Father in heaven through Jesus Christ. So if you don't have that relationship, now there's no time like the present. Now is the time. Now's the time to understand, to get that chip off your shoulder, to get that lump of coal out of your heart, however, whatever one metaphor you want to use, whatever's holding you back from God, you need to sever that and go to him. You are his child, you accept that, you acknowledge that, you believe that, you build on his word, you establish that in yourself. Psalm 73:26 says, my flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart, my portion forever. Discouragement is evil's greatest weapon in the battle of the mind. Counting our burdens rather than our blessings is detrimental. We need to focus on his strength and not our weakness. Lord, show me what I need to do for you. Show me what I can be for you. So to those who have kids, those who are responsible for children, you know what it's like when you wish your kids would tell you about their problems. That's how God feels about us in prayer. That was a quote from Peggy Spencer. I really liked that, and I wrote it down. That's how God feels. It's such an easy thing. You want your kids to talk to you about your problems. They hide them from you, and they lie to you, and they say there's nothing going on. You can read it on their face. God wants that from you. He wants you to tell him your problems. He wants you to pray and speak to him. Have that internal dialogue to the point where you can say, Lord, I need this, and you know he's there. He's not going to answer right away, but it's not instantaneous. It's like Jim O'Neill says, it's on God's time. It's not on our time. When he's ready, he'll let it happen. Father God, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for the fathers in the room. I thank you that you are a heavenly Father in heaven, that you teach us how to love. You teach us how to raise our children. You teach us how to just act and be around the people in this world. Continue to teach us to resist evil. Continue to give us a longing for your word, for your son, for our communities. Be with us. Let your will be done in our lives, Father God. Bless us as we go today. Bless us as we sing this last hymn. Bless us as we go into a time of prayer. We love you and praise you and thank you for all that you do for us in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
first song is will be on the screen, Change My Heart, O God, I think. Oh, all right. Well, hang on. We can still sing a prayer song. We'll pick one out right quick.
On the fly.
On the fly.
As I say.
What do you think, Patty? I think just the chorus of Sweet Hour of Prayer is in the hymnal.
Yeah, there we go.
Sweet Hour of Prayer is 433 in your blue hymnal, and this will be our prayer song.
If you'd like to stand with us as you're able.
433. Yeah, Change My Heart, O God, not on the screen.
We're scratching that idea.
Oh, if you have any prayer requests, Larry will get them from you.
On his way up.
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne make all my wants and wishes.
He's going to come up and pray for us.
Heavenly Father, we thank thee, Lord, for being our Lord and our God and always with us. Wherever we go and whatever we do, that you're still there. Surround us with your well-being and forgiveness of grace of all that is infected with us. Yesterday I had a privilege of seeing the answered prayer. Candy is home and at a party and eating, and she has oxygen, but the COVID did a job on her. They didn't expect her to live, and yet she's home and in her own home. And soon as well is back up at the church, and her husband's preaching today, and we just pray a blessing there on them they still need care and that, but you answered a lot of prayers, a lot of people praying, and the trueness of all. And John Palmer family is, they suddenly are in grief, and he's passed away this week, and touch him and bless the family and those that are grieving, and touch them and care for them. And to Father's Day, to see the family in church, the little ones running around, and that, what a blessing, Lord. Your care and guidance, and keep them. Be with those at Heman's camp that this week, and hear the good preaching, and to bless that, Lord, and winning souls to Christ. Be with our missionaries, wherever they're serving you, and Lord, as well, care for them, and protect them, Lord, because the church is under fire, and in this country as well, that our nation is being shaken right now with all this evilness, and care, and the morals are gone, and that, but Lord, you are there, and you're true, and we know that you're in control, and to give us patience, Lord, and consider that, keep us safe, keep the evil one from us, and for Satan to be defeated, and the Antichrist is gone. This we pray, Lord, bless this church, bless the people, bless those in prayer at the altar, and care for them, and bless them, Lord, and answer their prayers. Keep us safe, in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Our Family Matters, the baby bottle campaign for the pregnancy resource centers. Those need to be returned by the end of June. June 19th through to 26th, so that starts today and ends next week, is a family camp at Heman's up on 53 north of Marlette. Next week, we have Randy Ernst will be preaching here for us. Tuesday at 7 p.m., we have the prayer video call. If you'd like to get in on that, you need to contact Bruce. Wednesday at noon, there's a Bible study here in the pastor's office. Wednesdays at 7 p.m., we meet here for the worship team. And Sundays at 9:45, there is an adult class in the office with Larry. And if you'd please pray about giving an extra offering towards our new lawnmower. So far, we've already received $5,181 towards a total of $6,730. So keep that in your prayers, and we appreciate your giving to that. Our tithes and offerings will be in the white boxes at the edge as you exit, and we appreciate you tithing. And Leanne has something back there. I call her Mom. Service is usually at 7, isn't it? Normally. Yeah, it's usually 7 p.m. evening services out at Heman's. It's a good time. It's an awesome campground.
Those who are interested in going to the ladies' brunch, the sign-up sheet's back here. If you pay ahead of time, it's $17.
$70? Inflation's crazy. Keep it coming. Do we have the doxology on there?
Yes. I think it was right. It next week.
Nope, not that one.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, it is. It's just on a weird screen. If you'd like to stand with us for the doxology. in peace and have a blessed Father's Day. Don't forget there's stuff to take with you if you're a father.